And let's begin by reflecting on that word, lightning, in the context of the technological innovations that really can transform societies. Lightning, I think, is a word filled with metaphoric meaning. We so often use the idea of lightning to describe the way somebody is struck by a new idea. People talk about flashes of inspiration or moments of illumination. And of course, lightning is forever associated with Benjamin Franklin, the great inventor who discovered electricity by flying his kite in a thunderstorm in my native Philadelphia. But in fact, lightning may actually be a misleading metaphor when it comes to innovation, especially of the technological kind, because innovation never comes in a flash, and it certainly doesn't often come in the form of a bolt. Quite the contrary. Innovation actually is not about a moment of insight, it's the product of a process. This morning, we've heard many fascinating views about how innovation and technology can really open societies, improve democratic processes, and actually change people's lives productively. As we heard our speakers, Miller and Ayala talked about what it takes to create game-changing innovation. Meyer talked about mapping crises and potential ways to help in ways that conceptually linked very interestingly, I think, to Braverman's personal ambassador approach in the way that people really are engaged in the process of transformation. Gurumurthy talked about technology to disrupt at the local level, while of course Miller talked about how to enable those who govern to produce at the local level more inclusive, more sustainable cities. And all of these are important. All of these represent a process of social change that's worth our understanding and our attention. Let me explain very briefly what I mean by using another electric example. Many of us were saddened by the passing of Steve Jobs last month. We remember him as such a brilliant inventor. And he certainly is credited with dozens of patents. But when it comes to the products that we most associate with his genius, his talent was actually not invention, it was innovation. For instance, Jobs didn't invent the personal computer. He built on and he perfected existing inventions, including a graphical user interface pioneered by the Xerox Corporation many, many years before the first Macintosh ever rolled off an assembly line. And Jobs didn't invent touchscreen technology or mobile communication devices, but the iPhone and the iPad are examples of a process of recombinant innovation that took elements and reassembled them in truly unprecedented ways to create entirely new product categories that revolutionized modern society. We know at Rockefeller from now almost 100 years of experience that there is tremendous power in recombinant innovation as a process that drives innovation and then social change. When we created IRI, the International Rice Research Institute, 50 years ago, and seconded best scientists to this experimental facility in the Philippines, we began the process literally of recombinant innovation, where genetic research had produced many, many new seed varieties, but through sophisticated techniques of recombination, new crop varieties were produced that fed hundreds, millions of people in South Asia and Southeast Asia, what we now call the Green Revolution, that saved a billion lives in Asia. We, working with DFID and the Gates Foundation, are now trying to produce the same outcome in Africa through AGRA, the Alliance for a Green Revolution in Africa, again, looking to recombinant innovation technologies to produce more robust seeds, more robust soil that really will help the smallholder farmers of Africa in the next decade. We hope to cut food insecurity in 20 African countries and double the incomes of 20 million smallholder farmers. To build on that legacy of creating IRI, let me tell you about one of the most recent technological innovations, and it's called, nicknamed Scuba Rice, a variety of rice that's able to withstand complete submergence for up to 20 days. A rice breeder at UC Davis had a single gene line that was, when cultivated, able to withstand the flooding, but produced very low yields and had other agronomic attributes that were not desired by farmers. Using Erie's gene bank, Dr. Mackill, the scientist, was able to take other elements from other chromosomes and other pieces of the DNA of a variety of rices and actually developed high-yielding flood-immune rice varieties, as we call them now, scuba rice. Since rising sea levels and rain-induced flooding are predicted to cause a 15% drop in rice production in developing countries in the coming years, scuba rice can save countless lives from famine and improve the livelihoods of more than millions of people throughout India and throughout Southeast Asia. But our commitment to using technology to innovation certainly goes far beyond grains and far beyond agriculture. We continue to invest in the process of innovation as a means of discovering and deploying new techniques and technologies to address many other social challenges. Take crowdsourcing, for example. Patrick Meyer gave us the most vivid, compelling example of really using crowdsourcing in a compelling way. I'd like to give one that shows how government has used this as well. Applying this globally, last year we funded a crowdsourced competition for the G20 that allowed the G20 to search for new game-changing ideas on how small and medium-sized enterprises can have the financing structures they need to grow and scale most effectively. Using the Ashoka web-based platform, we presented this problem literally to the world, and the G20 had a variety, hundreds, I think thousands actually, of responses. They picked 17 winners, and to those winners, they committed collectively over $500 million in new funding. So governments are looking for creative new ways to really access the world. And this is really critical because, in the word of one of our partners, the game changer today is that in the 21st century, if you want an answer, if you want a good answer, ask everyone. Let me close by describing one last innovation process for you. Healthcare in the developing world, as we all know, is begging not only for new drugs and new dollars, but also for new innovative systems, new processes that have revolutionary potential. Mobile devices represent an unprecedented opportunity to provide innovative healthcare delivery to millions at the bottom of the pyramid and to transform healthcare the way M-Pesa has transformed banking for the poor in Kenya. Today, we're supporting a variety of innovative mobile health systems in countries throughout the developing world. Take, for example, the Pakistani NGO Heartfile, founded by Dr. Sanya Nishtar. Heartfile deploys a new emergency mobile funding mechanism that seeks to increase access to healthcare by leveraging technology to streamline donations to a health equity fund for the uninsured. Imagine a poor day laborer in Pakistan who needs a $400 emergency surgery after a life-threatening accident, but he earns only $70 a month, and that feeds a family of six. Before Heartfile, he waited months. But now at the hospital, via a mobile device, a healthcare worker first verifies the patient's poverty status with the government database, and then relays a request to Heartfile for financial assistance. Heartfile's Health Equity Fund appeals to donors around the world on behalf of this particular patient through its web-based platform, and funding is released for the surgery within 72 hours of the accident. Then donors are regularly updated on the use of their contribution and the recovery of their patient in real time through SMS messaging. In Bangladesh, we're funding a program through Brock's Manoshi Maternal and Neonatal Healthcare Service to deploy mobile solutions for slum dwellers. In a slum in Dhaka, I recently watched as a pregnant woman's hypertension was diagnosed using a cell phone. She was then treated using SMS texting between a just literate healthcare worker and a physician at the main hospital miles away, providing life-saving care. That is the innovation process at work, and it is helping to open opportunity and change people's lives. It's a kind of performance-enhancing drug, so to speak, for those of us who are working to solve the world's most pressing challenges. And this indeed is a prescription that is more necessary, I would hold, than ever before. Because as you in this room know better than most, there is not now, and there never will be enough money in the world to solve the challenges that we face. Yet when the push of our efforts comes up against the shove of global challenges, I think we now have a lead maker on our side, and that is innovation. That's why we must bring together new knowledge and new technology with a new, more globalized pool of talent. That's why we must not only seek to invent anew, but we must rework and reframe and recombine what we already have and what we already know into something that is vastly more powerful. And that's why we must invest in the process of innovation to build a better and more open society, the type of society we've heard about this morning. Because we not only have the obligation to build a better world, I think we actually have the ability to do so. Thank you.